to have you all here, and welcome to this presentation by the composer Olivia Bloch. I first heard Olivia Bloch's name because it kept coming up as an artist that the Experimental New Music Group, what was the name?
Experimental Music Study Group.
Study Group, a study group wanted to have, actually. And it was Joanna Helms, raise your hand, Joanna, who brought Olivia Bloch's name to my attention. And then, not long after that, there was this fabulous review in the New York Times, one of the best reviews I've ever seen, about the concert that she had. It seemed inevitable that this should happen, and it finally did. I will say that she is very hard to track down, because she never stays in one place for very long. Chicago is listed as the epicenter, but she is around the world at Scandinavia, like every other day, right?
Yeah.
A lot these days, yeah. She does sound installations, big, I guess, multimedia is probably the right word.
Yeah.
Is it there?
Yeah.
Okay, multimedia, it's up there. Pieces that just fill up a space, as will be the case tomorrow night. She's one of the most interesting artists working right now in sound and environmental construction, I guess is the word I want. Please welcome Olivia Bloch.
Studio compositions, this is my latest LP that just came out. It's called Facilities.
on the right, what you see there is film meter, rows of film meter. And so what film meter is, for those who don't know, it's the, if you, you know, if you remember, if you're old enough to remember going to the movies when you could see if it was actually a film, 35 millimeter film, you could see the leader before the film started. And these leaders are just like numbers, text and things, and the leader tells the projector what to do, the projectionist. So it tells the projectionist when to start the sound, when to start the film. It actually tells you who owns the film. So to me, I was interested in using these leaders and scores because in a way they already are scores. They're cinematic scores for these parts of cinema that you don't see. The projectionist, for instance, and the other component in this piece, it was for an ensemble called Yard and Meyer from New York, which is two percussionists and two pianists. So I had these percussionists doing Foley sound, basically. So, and what Foley sound is you know, back in the old days when movies were being made, someone had to do the sound effects for those movies. And so there are these big studios, these Foley studios with like incredible just objects everywhere, like pieces of glass, you could put like shoes with sticks so that you could just like do footsteps. All of these sounds that you hear in these films were all from these Foley artists. So my intention with this piece was to sort of bring out these invisible elements of cinema and to make sound out of those elements. And in fact, the whole idea of hey, I was about to read it. And the idea of cinema will come up again. It's something that really informed my work a lot. Performance, I do a lot of mostly solo performance these days. I do inside piano pieces, and as I said earlier, I like to work with materials so the piece on the lower right is me just piling wood, and so that was basically the piece, was just constructing this big pile of wood, and the idea was that I was just focusing on the sound of this wood, which is actually a very complex sound if you concentrate and listen to it timbrally. There's a lot going on. And then, of course, I do, you know, these surround sound pieces on my laptop, use electronic sounds a lot. And then, more and more recently, I've been using these little sort of lo-fi sound making objects, which is, and here's one of them, it's a micro cassette player. And walkie-talkies, things like beds outside in a beautiful mountainous kind of climate and just let the air sort of heal you, the fresh air, the sunshine. And so I was just thinking about this theme of air. So I had curtains made out of surgical gauze so they kind of floated in the wind, and then there were these sounds. You can't see the speakers, but there are speakers there with the sounds of breath kind of coming through. So it was all of these kind of layers of like white noise, wind, breath kind of sounds that all sort of mix together. Multimedia, I do a lot now with 35 millimeter slides that are layered. I like slide projectors a lot. I like the sound of slide projectors. I like to move the focus between the two images a lot. So one of the larger themes in my work, and Alan kind of mentioned this, is basically site specificity. And what I mean by that is that I pay attention. Sound is basically, I think, more so than you know, waves of light even. Like, it's inseparable from the space that you're in. It activates the materials of the space, and there's, you know, there's a little bit of resonance that we can hear now because of the hard surfaces, floor, and, you know. So I'm interested in acoustics, and I'm interested in actually, like, bringing those things out in a space, so almost like sounding out the location where we are. So these are two of my colleagues that I worked with for a while. We would, this is John Bisnick and Seth Neal. And we used to stage these sort of like performances in sites in Austin when I lived there in Austin, Texas. So we would do things in like resonant drainage tunnels, using whatever was actually in those places. So we would use like rocks or leaves or and just like throw things, basically just using whatever was there. And so that approach and experience kind of informed my idea of what improvisation is. And to me, what improvisation is, or my interest in improvisation, is that it just is the space, basically. You kind of get a sense of where you are, and you either use materials from the space, or you use the space itself, or you treat the improvisation instead of sort of context of both of those kinds of sounds are different than what they usually would be. So I'm going to play an excerpt of a piece called Heave To, which is my attempt to kind of recreate like a storm at sea. So we'll listen to a little bit of this. So what I want to do is let's raise the screen, and maybe if you guys can keep working on this, I'll
do it.
And so one of the challenges that I'd like to think about is to try to change the context so much with these musical bits that it's almost like you don't really do that anymore. So it's just like a cognitive kind of shift or something, or at least I like to think it is. But one of the themes that I use in my work a lot is wind. I'm really attracted to the sound of wind, and just kind of like variations on white noise sounds in general. So you can hear that in the piece that we just heard. I am doing a lot with orchestra these days, and usually the way that I do that is to write a piece for orchestra, then we will do the piece, do a concert, I will take a recording of that concert and then work with the recording, sort of layer it or change it in some way and do kind of almost like a studio version of the orchestral piece, so it's changed a little bit. So there's a piece that a release that came out a couple years back called Heron, and this is the sort of more orchestral piece. I'll play a little bit of this opening night. Sounds in certain places. pipe organs are really great for both of those things. So what I'm gonna do now is try to play this organ a little bit and take advantage of some of the sort of more liminal kinds of effects that these organs can have. And what I'll try to do is start by sort of blending in with the room and then have the sounds come out a little bit and see what happens. Maybe I'll fail, I don't know. And these kinds of patterns Some of the exercises I have set up today are kind of for her, and I have a lot to do with her sound meditations. So, one of the exercises that I want to do is just called room sound, and it's basically like kind of what I just did in the beginning of that piece that I just played you for that improvisation. And you can do this with anything. You can do it with your voice. You can do it with a pen on paper. You can make sound however you want to make sound. But and I've done this exercise with Pauline, and she's very like strict about the dynamics of this because it's all about dynamics, really. I mean, it's a little bit about the timbre too, but. The idea is to simply listen to where you are and then kind of catch your ear onto a sound that you hear and then contribute in an additive way to that sound. So, but contribute to it so that you all, like I sitting here, cannot tell the difference between you and the room. Does that make sense? So obviously you can't do anything that's like much louder, but it's going to be quiet, right? And then as the piece goes on, you kind of keep adding a little bit of presence to your sound until what you're responding to is everybody else making sound, or the room becomes you. So do you want to try that? You don't have to do it if you don't want, but so if you have instruments, you can get them out. If you don't, no problem. And what I like to do for this is actually get up and like go to different parts of the room, so it just becomes like you are the space. So I think we should just get up and move around a little bit, and I'll give you the go ahead. Mm-hmm. So we're going to do an improvisation. Again, you do whatever you want. If you, who is going to not participate in this? I need to know that. Everyone's in? Thank you. count one after the other, two consecutive counts, basically. So basically we're gonna just shout out the numbers in, you know, in order until we get to 20. And if we get to 20, then we win. But if two people talk at the same time, we start at one again. Okay? So you have to talk loud enough where we can hear you. The other detail of this game is that you need to kind of, the pace should be pretty fast. All right? You want to try it? Ready to go? All right. One.
Thank you.